had participations of more than 250 corporates, and over 75 awards were given to the most deserving leaders and companies from various industries. This year, we present to you the Middle East Asia Leadership Summit and Awards, where you create an opportunity for leaders to meet leaders from different sectors, to build their network, share and exchange experiences and ideas, discuss latest trends in leadership, and most importantly, get recognized at the highest level. I would like to thank Colabera for their ever-extending support, and especially Mr. Mehul Shah and Mr. Sunny Shah. And let us thank our sponsor, without whom the event wouldn't be possible. Knowledge partner, Colabera Tact. Official travel partner, Vingo Vacation. Silver partner, Career Innovators. Associate sponsors, Vivek Bindra. Associate sponsor, Khalees Perfume. And without further ado, I would like to invite on stage Mr. Sunny Shah from Colabera and Global Head, the World Leadership Federation, to begin the inauguration ceremony. Please put your hands together. Would you like a separate mic?
Well, as they say, if you're actions inspire others to learn more, do more, achieve more, and accomplish more, you are a leader. With this objective in mind, we sowed the seeds of World Leadership Federation in 2016. The objective of us establishing this institute was to celebrate excellence in leadership across all industries. We strongly believe that leadership does not have any boundaries. It could be in any sectors. And as you would see today, we've been giving awards across various segments, across various industries. Age has no barrier here. You'll see 10-year-old children coming on stage and getting awards for excellence that they've shown in their respective roles. And you'll also see people who've been veterans in the industry. Without taking much of the time and being a spoiled sword between you and your moment, I would like to officially announce this award ceremony as open. Thank you so much. I would like to invite one of our jury members, Ms. Rama Mundra, on stage. Rama is an IIM Calcutta graduate. She is an official visiting faculty for the IIM Ahmedabad, and she's a Harvard Business Publishing official trainer. So please put your hands together for Rama Mundra. She would like to share some experience about her being a part of jury. Rama, welcome.
Right behind you always.
Thank you.
Good morning. They say coffee and conversations are the best thing to happen. I think Sunny would agree with me on that. This idea of recognizing leaders in every age, for every phase of life, initiated on a coffee and talking about it. And Sunny just casually mentioned that leaders are everywhere. They inspire us, motivate us, take us ahead. It's so important to recognize them. And they can be, as you see, they can be any age. That's where, and I just casually mentioned once again to him and say, oh, there should be somebody who should take the initiative and recognize them. And with Sunny, and I'm sure that most of you would see that happening, and his team, the moment you say, there should be someone doing it, they are the first people to jump up and say, we will do that. And that's where World Leadership Federation started. I'm lucky to have been a part of it ever since the journey began. And as they say, these journeys are sometimes long, slightly tiring, but what keeps us going is people like you. You are the reason that World Leadership Federation comes together, inspire, innovate, and be there. You aren't there, we aren't there. So today, when I stand here and look at you, I look at many more partners who are joining us. So be our partner, be our companion, walk with us together. Let's make world a better place with better leaders. Thank you so much. Look forward to this. This is your moment, your glory. I'm just looking forward to be there and clap with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Rama. And the event will honor leaders for their outstanding contributions towards the growth in economic, educational, social, art, and leadership development. World Leadership Federation will also present an opportunity for leaders to learn about the latest worldwide leadership trends and discuss about the same at the Common Forum. Let us move on to the next segment, and it is time to invite on stage our first guest speaker. The first topic of the day is develops the possibilities through leadership excellence. And I would like to invite on stage Mr. Sanit Vijayaratne, the CEO of Carbon Consulting Company Sri Lanka. Mr. Sanit Vijayaratne guided the company to not only become the most recognized provider of carbon assessments, mitigation and offset solutions, but also to become known for its expertise in a diverse array in sustainability solutions. Put your hands together for Mr. Vijayaratne.
Thank you very much. Good morning to you all. It's nice to be here. And I apologize at the outset. I'm going to use this thing. It's a little new, so forgive the snafus of PowerPoint that generally happen with this. Talking about the possibilities of through leadership excellence, I was going to drag a little bit of our story here and a five-year journey that's taken us from us being a startup social enterprise to where we are now. And so the story revolves a lot around myself, and I apologize for that beforehand. It does seem a little like bragging, but this was the moral behind this whole event. This was me 6 years ago, very happy, very content with some of these. The gang of girls I used to work with at the agency. I was very content heading up strategic planning and communication for what was then the hottest startup communication agency in Sri Lanka. I'd spent 10 years or 8 years in advertising, marketing, and communication before going on to co-found this agency, which in the first 3 years became the most awarded communication agency in the country. Some of you may be hearing about the Advertising Effectiveness Awards. It's called the Effie Awards. And we won the first ever gold Effie. It made us the most awarded agency. 8 people, the most awarded agency in the country. And that was really quite an achievement for us. I was happy. I was on the National Industry Body. I was a director of the Advertising Industries Association, doing what I do, doing what I love. Getting recognized for it, and life was good. Then I had a very interesting meeting with some green people. Not that kind. These guys. A couple of these people, and two of them were third generation businessmen. They'd started companies. They wanted to work with companies in Sri Lanka to get them to take their first steps towards becoming greener and more sustainable. And one of them, this is Subramaniam, he's been a speaker on the international circuit. He's the chairman of one of our largest tea exporting companies. They are currently the world's most sustainable tea company. He's one of my board members. This is the other board member, that's Professor Munasinghe. And if anybody heard of Al Gore and the movie he put together called Inconvenient Truth, Professor Munasinghe was the vice chairman of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. He shared the Nobel Prize with Al Gore, making him Sri Lanka's only Nobel laureate. And he's on my board of directors. Why am I showing this? These are the people who got together to start a company. Very passionate people, highly qualified, and they started a company called the Carbon Consulting Company. What they did was they hired a bunch of engineers. It's a social enterprise. A bunch of engineers and forestry specialists and carbon and technical people. And they said, well, you know, we want to make Sri Lanka a greener place. And a year later, a little over a year later, this was what happened. Not a single project had taken place. Company was hemorrhaging money, and they were forced to rethink. Their founding premise had been wrong. they thought because they wanted to be greener, that other companies would want to be greener themselves. And that turned out to be false. So 1 year later, they were in a bit of dire straits, and somebody mentioned my name to them. And they met up with me and gave me a question. They said, what are you willing to do to help save the planet? And that's a question that I had to take very seriously and said, okay, well, you know what? There's a company there. What can I do to help it? And I'm really happy to have my wife here. Had a long chat with her about it and said, should we take a chance on this? Do something. I spent 10 years in marketing. Before that, I was a corporate lawyer. I don't talk about that part. It's a bad part of my life, corporate law. But what can we do? It was a chance to do something different. It was a chance to make something meaningful of my life and do something real. I said, okay, fine. The offering they had, it was really compelling. Make corporate bodies aware of the impacts created, advise them on reducing carbon emissions, work with them to institute greener practices, give them an opportunity to compensate. Hey, all this seems like really, really worthwhile stuff. But it wasn't working. The question was, why wasn't it working? And nobody knew that. Environmentalists, even then, I'm talking 6 years ago, were seen as tree huggers, radicals, doomsday prophets, all those things. And nobody took them seriously. I still today, I don't call myself an environmentalist. I'm a sustainability advocate. I use various other things. But I never call myself an environmentalist because that's what they were seen as. So most people, and still today, didn't see a business value in protecting the environment. And the biggest challenge we have still today, 6 years later, is convincing board members and chairmen and directors that there is value in helping protect the environment that we live in. My very often saying is the biggest challenge to climate change is accountants, because they are trained to think in rupees and cents, dollars and cents. And that's all they are trained to think in. So we need to change the accountants first, and we might have a chance. But this is what happened. We decided to go ahead and say, well, challenge accepted. Let's see what we can do. And if anybody is familiar with this character, he's famous on TV called How I Met My Mother. And he's a guy called Barney Stinson, who's always saying challenge accepted. So this is what we did. The question was, how could I export the learnings that I had accumulated over 12 years of branding and marketing and communications into the sustainability field? And one of my idols has always been Steve Jobs. And one of the things he used to say that he dropped out of college, but he went to audit courses on graphic design and typefaces. He said the reason the Apple Mac had such wonderful typefaces was because he just dropped in for a typeface class. If he didn't quit class and just audit those courses, we wouldn't have had those computers that changed the world today. Lamborghini, for example, was a tractor maker who, because Ferrari annoyed him, decided to export those learnings from making tractors into making high-performance sports cars. So transferring knowledge between industries and learning is a very clearly established practice. So my challenge was to see whether you could take the concepts of marketing and strategy and build it into addressing this gap. Because there was a gap. There was a gap between companies and buying into sustainability and environment, which wasn't really being addressed. It sounds simple enough. What to do, how to do it, how to tell it, who to tell it to. This is like business class 101. And the businessmen around these tables will say, well, yeah, that's just common sense. The problem is it was new to sustainability. It's new to environment. And this was how we decided to tackle this problem. So the question is, all right, we decided to do this. Now what? Start by creating a brand. And I'm just going back to the slide that I showed you a couple of minutes ago. And I bet none of you realize that there were actually two companies here. And if you read those two logos, you have the Carbon Consulting Company on your left, on this side. And there's a sister company that had been started, which I didn't know till I actually joined, called the Conservation Carbon Company. And the people behind this had decided, well, let's use the same logo, what the hell. And this was, I said, you can't do this. You need to create a brand identity, a corporate image. And I was having a discussion with my fellow speaker over the table, and one of the first questions I asked the board of directors is, you're running a green industry, why is your logo not green? And they said, well, we didn't think of that. So there were two companies. One was to do a carbon footprint assessment and strategy and offsetting. The other one was to run rainforest reforestation projects. So there were two very distinct companies there. We needed to create a separate brand. And that was the first step. And this was what we started out with. It was green. It had footprint because we did footprints. Nobody knew what a footprint was at the time that we started this. And it had the globe because we were all about saving the planet. And we built our whole prospects around this. How to do it was simple. We had a bunch of engineers and PhD guys, and we did a whole bunch of technical services. So we knew how to do it. That's fine. Now question was who to tell, how to tell it to. We started by integrating communication into everything we do. This is all internal communication pieces that my environmental consulting team does for its clients free of charge. Because that's the only way to build internal stakeholders, get them to talk to their clients about it. We started by sending out stuff to them and saying, do an internal campaign. 6 months later, they hadn't done an internal campaign. We did a poster and said, hey, you know, guys, print it out. Here's it on email, print it out and put it up in your boardroom. They didn't put it. Now we design it ourselves, we print it ourselves, we hand it over to them and say, kindly nail it to your wall, and now it happens. And why we are doing it is to create that business value. People don't understand the intrinsic value that environment brings. We created a value system that they could understand so that they save the planet as just an ancillary part of it. We're saying, well, do something good from a CSR point of view. We'll help you communicate it. And by the way, we save the planet. Hey, what the hell? That started to work. We worked with our partners' communication team to work on marketing communication pieces that started hitting the newspapers and started making waves. We started making some headlines from the regional standpoint with some of our clients. And we started doing PR for them. Whoever heard of an environmental company doing PR? But by creating a value system that people understood, because sustainability and CSR often sat under marketing people, we created an offering that people valued, which then happened to serve the purpose. And that's exactly what made us work. Without going into too many specifics, just some of the things we've been able to do in the last 4 or 5 years was create Asia's first carbon neutral apparel factory, Asia's first carbon neutral hotel, the world's first water neutral apparel factory, the world's first carbon neutral tea, and the list goes on. It's not bad for a little country sitting on the bottom end of India and working in this region. It's not bad for an industry that didn't exist 4 years ago. And this was... it's very humbling to be able to do this. We've been blessed that the approach has worked, the strategy worked. I'm here today because people started recognizing what we've done. I was really happy to be in Mumbai last week where they awarded me the Global CSR Leadership Award in the award ceremony at Mumbai for the work that we've done. I'm really happy to be here talking to you. Hopefully, I've inspired a few people to think a little out of the box in what you do, and that'll serve you well. So, thank you very much for having me. I'll be here if anybody wants to talk to me about it later on, but thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Sanit Vijayaratne. And now I would like to call our next speaker, Mr. Murad Salman Mirza, Innovative Thought Leadership, globally published author, Human Resource UAE. Mr. Murad Salman Mirza has 20 years of multidisciplinary experience in organizational development, talent management, and business transformation in a rich array of roles. He's a master in organizational development, talent management, business transformation, change management, diversity and inclusion, and lots more. Put your hands together for Mr. Murad Salman Mirza.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be addressing you. Can you hear me? It's on now? All right, ladies and gentlemen, again, absolute pleasure being here at this wonderful forum. I'll be concentrating on leadership excellence for the digital age, and I'd like to make it interesting by starting with a short story. The gentleman's name is Vasily Arkhipov. I don't know if many of you know about him, but let me start with this story. During the Cuban Missile Crisis, there was Russian submarines facing off American ships near Cuba. And one of the submarine commanders could not get in touch with the headquarters because they were too deep underwater, and they were getting desperate because they were not getting any instructions. There was a tense standoff, and some action needed to be taken. So what happened was that the submarine captain decided to go for a nuclear launch. Now, this nuclear launch had a procedure. This procedure required the unanimous vote of three people: the submarine commander himself, the second in command, which was Vasily, and the political agent on that submarine. Ladies and gentlemen, Vasily was the only one that had the courage, the insight, the foresight, the confidence not to go for that vote. And all of you are here, myself included, because of one vote that happened on a Russian submarine. And not many people know that this gentleman actually saved the world. Not the President of the United States, not the Premier of the Soviet Union, this gentleman. One vote, gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, one vote. Now, this gentleman converted a possibility of peace into an opportunity for peace. What happened was he convinced the captain. The captain ultimately surfaced. They got in touch with their headquarters. There was no nuclear strike, and the thing was put off. And the rest is history. This is how close things come to in organizations also. So I'm going to come back to Vasily at the end of my presentation. Let me give you some tips on how do we go about converting possibilities into opportunities. Because especially in the digital age, there's so much at stake. So much is unknown. So much is changing. You really have to be on your toes all the time. So here's the first one. Being a visionary isn't enough. You have to be a futurist. Ladies and gentlemen, do you remember Nokia? Anybody remember Nokia? About 80% of the market of phone? Where'd that go? Don't you think the Nokia CEO had a vision? But they did not have the capability or the ability to foresee how a platform-based handheld device could revolutionize the whole thing. When Nokia was being sold to Microsoft, the CEO of Nokia was crying. And when he was crying, he said, "We did everything right, but we still lost." Now think about that statement, ladies and gentlemen. Did he do everything right? He was a visionary. But see, the demand of the future is not a visionary. Ladies and gentlemen, it's not enough. You cannot just start or keep on looking at your own organization. You have to look at the ecosystem. Your main products may not be the main products in future. A side project may become the core product for you. All right? Look at Kodak. Anybody remember Kodak? The Kodak moments? In the 70s, an engineer at Kodak presented to his senior management an idea of making pictures without a film. No film. In the 70s, he was laughed at and the project was shelved. Anybody know what happened to Kodak? It got bankrupted in 2010, I believe, and it's on a rebuild phase right now, and digital cameras are all over. No film. Blockbuster Video, anybody know that? Biggest video rental in the world? Everybody knows Netflix, right? In 2000, Netflix offered Blockbuster Video the sale of Netflix for $50 million. $50 million. You know where Blockbuster Video is right now? It's history, nowhere. And you know what is the revenue for Netflix last year? $9 billion, ladies and gentlemen. And it's basically a digital channel now. It started out as a CD by email, by mail company, all right? So this is what is happening if you're not a futurist. Secondly, invest in open and flexible talent management systems that allow breathing space for free thinkers and trendsetters. Ladies and gentlemen, we have policies, procedures. We like to conform to them. We laud people who actually are people who can, you know, really perform within those dimensions and boundaries. Innovation does not recognize boundaries, ladies and gentlemen. It requires free thinking. It needs the space to think. It requires the encouragement to go across boundaries. Those boundaries themselves are restrictions. So just check your own talent management systems. Are they binding? Are they open? Are they accommodating? Do they make enough space for productive rebels? We need more rebels, ladies and gentlemen, if you need to survive in the digital age. Not insular conformists. All right? That was a given. That's not going to happen. Not going to happen in the future. Number three, be welcoming of the increasingly sensitized and connected world. Ladies and gentlemen, everybody's watching. Whatever you do, everybody's watching. I was talking to my friends over at my table, and I was saying, as soon as you put up a web page, you're global. You may be sitting in some small state thinking that you're not known, you're known. Somebody's looking at you, always. Somebody could put up a review on Glassdoor, an anonymous one, and either you make it or you are broken. All right, ladies and gentlemen, corporate reputations are increasingly fragile, very fragile. Some contractor does something in some small part of the world and a big multinational has to apologize. I'll give you an example. Big three in the U.S., big three airlines. United Airlines, American Airlines, Delta Airlines. All right, big three. So this guy, a few years ago, he's a musician. He boards a United Airlines flight. He has a guitar which gets broken, $3,500 guitar. He goes to the United baggage services, asks for a replacement or a compensation. He's refused. Tries for quite a few months, he's not given anything in return. Just given the corporate line that it's not possible. So what does that guy do? Ladies and gentlemen, he goes, makes a song, makes a wonderful video, makes the title, United Breaks Guitars. Puts it on YouTube. It gets six figures in views in its first week. It leads to a 10% drop in the stock value of United, about $180 million at that time. And United's chief customer experience officer, let's put it that way, has to call him, apologize, try to make things right by offering to pay for the guitar, which he doesn't accept. So they make a donation on his behalf to a charity. But the damage is done, right? I checked the YouTube video 2 days ago. It has more than 16 million views. And he actually made a career out of it. So this is how the fragility of organizations work, ladies and gentlemen. Very fragile. The next, don't undermine innovation with technology by marginalizing the human factor. Ladies and gentlemen, we're all in love with technology. You know, everything, every day, something new, fancy is coming up. We are enamored with it. You know, something got really easier for us. But here's the thing, innovation is not equal to technology, ladies and gentlemen. Innovation is application of human ingenuity. It is a much broader thing. Technology is an enabling tool. It's part of the result that happens from innovation. But a lot of the organizations start labeling innovation as technology, which is the big mistake. Trust your people, ladies and gentlemen. They are the solution providers for you. They have the solutions for you. If you buy a technology to replace or make things more efficient, first make sure that you trust your people to come up with the right solutions. Because sometimes that technology might not be needed, or a lesser level of technology might do. You don't have two, three technologies competing with each other in the same organization, or the customization might not happen. So please be careful about innovation and mixing it up with technology. Innovation is a much, much broader, a humanistic concept. Technology is a more mechanistic application of the thing. So make sure that you do not compare or take the same, take both of them in the same breath, because that's confusing the issue here. Innovation is much broader. Again, ingrain diversity and inclusion as a core part of the organization culture and instill confidence boosting measures to drive fear out of the workplace. Dr. Deming said, do not have fear in the workplace. Diversity and inclusion is very important. Globally, we are getting diverse by the moment. Again, the challenge sometimes for organization is increasingly not diversity, because sometimes by default that happens, it's inclusion. So diversity has a bit of a side disadvantage of becoming a marketing ploy, but inclusion is where the action happens. Are they really included in your big decision making? Are they making things happen for you? Or are they just some pictures on a board, some numbers on a dashboard, on a HR dashboard or a management dashboard? Make them inclusive, ladies and gentlemen. The next one, make sure that succession planning and management is impartial and transparent. Everybody's looking. The word gets around, ladies and gentlemen. Who got the nod? Who didn't? Who got bypassed? Who got ignored? Everybody knows that. You cannot hide it. So make sure you preserve the psychological contract, the big demotivator. It actually hurts the organization. So if you're trying to convert possibilities into opportunities, do not ignore that the succession planning and management process has to be really, really transparent and impartial. And that's really important for the future of the organization. The next one is cultivate high commitment employees, which I call HICOs, instead of high potential employees, which are known as HIPOs. High commitment is actually focusing on commitment. Ladies and gentlemen, commitment comes from inside. It's an intrinsic value. High potential, that's an extrinsic judgment. All right? Committed people are very difficult to be poached by competitors. If you have committed people to their work, to their organization, to their own well-being, to progressing the field, they will be the cornerstone of your success. They will be the drivers of converting possibilities into opportunities. Your talent runs deep. Don't segment it. There's already too much politics in organizations. If you do that, you're just making a refined form of the normal distribution curve. It just makes matter worse. And those hypos, you think they're going to stick with you for a long time? They don't, because they get noticed by other competitors and they get poached very easily. And let me just add to that, a recent Harvard HR research study actually found out that 40% of the so-called hypos are not hypos. So 40% of the organizations have hypos, which are actually not hypos. So the people who are supposed to be getting selected are not actually getting selected in the first place, about in about 40% of the organization. The next one, inculcate mentorship as a mandatory element of senior management's performance appraisal. Ladies and gentlemen, that used to be desirable. It's a requirement now. People need that sort of an extra incubation to make sure they stick around long enough to prove themselves and rise up the corporate ladder. If they don't, if they get demotivated, they're going to drop out. They're going to look for greener pastures elsewhere. You're going to lose out on the leadership part. Make sure that does not happen. The next one is convert aspirational employee engagement into inspirational employee engagement. Aspirational is you see somebody doing good, you think that's the way to do things, you do it. But it's not translated from inside you. So when you get to do something by looking at somebody or the way the culture is, you gotta inculcate it inside yourself. You make sure how you'd wanna do it is look at the core values. Are those core values binding you? Are they driving you to make sure that this aspiration gets an inspirational aspect? Or you're just doing it because the organization says, well, we need to have engaged employees. Engagement comes from the inside, ladies and gentlemen. It doesn't come from outside. True engagement has to happen. Whether it's your security guard or your receptionist or a junior manager, whoever does it, you cannot see them all the time, but somebody does it. If they do it, it better be because they're inspired to do it. And what's inspiring them? The core values that are the binding force for them to do it. So make sure that aspirational aspect translates into the inspirational aspect. The next one, inculcate mentorship as a mandatory element of senior management's performance appraisal. Ladies and gentlemen, start testing your senior management on how good of a mentor they are. Do they have a second in command? Do they want a second in command? Do they get nervous if there's a second in command? See, that's the thing. Those are the tough questions. Sometimes if you get a successor, you start getting nervous. And that's where the questions come up. Do they have the courage to do that? If they don't, the organization is in trouble. Oh, sorry, I actually went back. The next one, befriend failures for learning and embrace successes with caution. Ladies and gentlemen, a few years back, Microsoft was running into trouble. Their traditional model of software licensing was going flat. They were not making huge inroads into cloud computing or artificial intelligence or mobile computing. Amazon and Apple were just taking the market away and they were in serious trouble. Now, Bill Gates could have tried to take the reins, come back, but he didn't. He had the foresight and the insight to elevate Satya Nadella from his cloud computing on the basis of his expertise in there, and he elevated him to the CEO position, and look where Microsoft has turned the fortunes around. It's in the vanguard of cloud computing now, artificial intelligence. So that's the thing where you need to have that level of humility where you can see where you've gone wrong, take a step back, and then take the right step, put the right people in place, and make sure that you move forward in a measured way. Let me leave you with some food for thought. Ladies and gentlemen, I like to define a business and an organization two different ways. A business, ladies and gentlemen, in the traditional corporate setup is profit focused. Everything is geared towards that. Organization is human focused, employee focused, you know, trying to revolve around that. If you have a great business and a poor organization, you're basically a soulless organization. You're dying from the inside. Might be doing good, might be a monopoly or duopoly, but you're losing the human factor and you're probably not going to be relevant in the future. There's no difference between you and a machine, and if you're competing with the machine on that aspect, you're going to lose out. Machines are getting better all the time. Poor business plus poor organization, disaster. Nothing to do with that. Poor business plus great organization leads to bankruptcy. That's unfortunately, a lot of the government organizations around the world run on that principle because they are looking at the higher principle of taking care of people. So lifetime employment, great benefits, no matter business makes a profit or not, you know, you get a cash injection, keep on going. But that's not the corporate way of doing things. The ultimate leadership success measure, ladies and gentlemen, is having a great organization and a great business. That's excellence. That's never going to change, whether it's the industrial age, the post-industrial age, the digital age, post-digital age. That stays. Now, here's some last word I want to leave with you. There was a time when Employee of the Month was big. Everybody wanted to be one. And what needed to be won, then what in that recognition? Ladies and gentlemen, in the digital age, forget Employee of the Month. That's cliched, that's compliance oriented. You know, it's just doesn't translate into quite the bit of difference that people can associate with. What I suggest is to reward and recognize Savior of the Month. And that's impact focused. What kind of impact a person, he or she did, which actually saved the organization, propelled the organization, and galvanized the organization. Look for those heroes and heroines. Cherish your heroes, ladies and gentlemen, or heroines. Those are the real drivers, the real saviors for you, okay? Because that's not a fashion statement. That's not a fad. That is something that really, really is at the root of an organization that wants to survive and thrive in the digital age. Let me come back to Vasily. Everybody remember Vasily? Yeah? All right. The submarine commander who wanted to launch the nuclear strike. Compliance-oriented, employee of the month. All right? He was following procedure. He had the authority as the captain. He could do it. Nobody could blame him if anybody was left there to blame him. But ladies and gentlemen, Vasily was the savior of the month. He took a stand, he made the impact, he convinced the captain, and he averted a major catastrophe, by reason of which we're all here. So ladies and gentlemen, at the very least, look at those heroes and heroines. Those are your saviors. Those are the prime drivers of converting possibilities into opportunities. See if you can find them, whether they're at the very basic level of your organization, whether they're mid-level or at the highest level. Thank you so much for your time and patience. I wish you best of success in your future personal and professional endeavors. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Murad Salman Mirza. It was a wonderful speech. The World Leadership Federation has crafted diverse, selected categories of awards for encouraging leaders who have been in the industry, may it be the start-up or a well-established one. The objective is to provide space for the next generation leaders and to bring to their cognizance that leadership starts from day one. The organizers are confident that the event will be able to give exposure to the young and immediate talents as well as established leaders. Well, but before we will get to the next segment, I would like to know you a bit more. So I will go down right now with the mic and ask you a few questions. So let's have some fun.